So for a keynote coming next, we have Sanjoe Tom Jose, CEO of Talview and the man behind Instahiring 2020 to reimagine recruitment. From yesterday, people have been congratulating us on a very nice show, and he's the man behind Instahiring 2020. So the loudest round of applause to Sanjoe today.
Thanks everyone for coming back for day two of Instahiring 2020. I hope all of you had a good time. This is the first time we are doing a two-day event. Last year it was a one-day event. We actually started with a three-hour event back in 2016. Then the next time it became a half-a-day event, and last year it was a full-day event, and this time we are doing a two-day event. So we are learning. So if there are hiccups or if there are experience issues which you faced while you're at Instahiring 2020, we would make it better. So please give your feedback to us. Today, I think we have been talking about recruitment for almost last, 18 hours or so, starting yesterday morning and then so far. Wanted to bring a different perspective to how we can look at recruitment, what we can learn from other fields, and how can we adopt some of the best practices from other areas of work in recruitment. So when you typically look at buzzwords which are out there, right? So the top buzzwords which you kind of hear, I'm sure, and all of you have all of you encounter these words at least three or four times every day in your daily life. So everything from artificial intelligence to blockchain, arbitrage, causation, correlation. Some of them are technologies. Some of them are consulting languages which kind of creep into your daily life. But I want to talk about one of those words, disruption. Probably I used the word disruption in my keynote yesterday, and you would have heard disruption multiple times yesterday. So what is really disruption? So when the word disruption, we think about it, most of us think about how technology disruptions happen. We think about these companies with thousands of patents. So we have Google, Intel, iPhone, maybe Tesla. Are all the changes in our personal and professional lives driven by just technology disruptions, or are there other form of disruptions? So, and what are those disruptions? Uber, I think Uber is something which all of us are customers of. For example, I don't own a car, so I take Uber every single day. But how many of you take Uber at least once a week? Yeah, almost, I think, 80% of the audience. So that's the reality of our life. But Uber hasn't brought in any specific technology innovation. They do have their patents, but they are not a technology disruptor the way Google or Intel or iPhone is, or Apple is. Swiggy, again, I don't cook very often. I eat every day out, so I'm the extreme in all of these cases. But how many of you order food online at least once a week? Again, 80%. Now, getting into the professional life, we all were used to managing all of our communication with emails, I think till maybe last year. But today, for example, if any of my team members have to reach out to me, if they send me an email mostly, I'm not looking at it, because for me, everything happens on the collaboration platform. So they have to actually ping me. If they have sent me an email, they have to ping me on the collaboration platform, letting me know that, hey, I've sent you an email, can you respond to that? So that's the reality of how things are evolving. How many of you, I think yesterday we got maximum number of interest from in the product booth, for the booth on Microsoft Teams. How many of you are actually using Teams or other platforms like Slack within your organization? Okay, I think close to 50%. So this is all the reality of life. Zoom is another example. So if you look at all of these companies, they are not really bringing in a lot of technology disruption, but they're bringing in disruption from the way of life standpoint. They are building models which is enabling existing technologies to be used in a much more productive manner to change the way you live on a day-to-day basis. And there are a lot of them. So apart from the ones we spoke about, there's Tesla, there's Airbnb. So on the left side, you have companies which kind of control this narrative for at least 30, 40 years before now. And on the right side, these are all companies which are coming up with new models. So what can we really learn from these companies? And Robert Lang, so he's a very senior Caltech PhD who was having a very successful career in technology. But he quit that job and he started doing origami. He quit the job and started doing origami, people were like, what are you doing? Because origami is things which kids do, right? Or this is not a profession. But today, by doing origami, his designs are being licensed by the likes of NASA and many of the leading automobile and rocket manufacturers for the purpose of designs for their products. So essentially, he has leveraged origami to build innovation in different areas where design is very critical. And his approach is almost all innovation happens by making connections between fields which on the first look are not connected. So we'll try and look at some of the disruptors today and what we can learn from these disruptors. So the first disruptor which I'm going to talk about, this is a company in the US which is focusing on experience and customer fit. How do you design experiences which are fit for your customers? So the company's name is Carvana. They are the largest car dealer in the US, and they became that in just 5 years. And in fact, they have a $12 billion market cap within 5 years of founding the company. I have a video. Can you play the video? So what Carvana, so the video focuses on their car vending machine, which is obviously part of the experience. But what it also is trying to convey, because they are targeting millennials as buyers, because bulk of the car purchases in the US is driven by millennials. And if you want to create a car buying experience for millennials, so you have to think completely different. So what they do is, you don't have to worry about any of your paperwork. All you need to do is just pick up the phone or go to the website, and just like you make an order on Amazon, you can make an order for Amazon. They do all the paperwork, they do everything. They deliver the car on your footstep. And if you drive it around, and if you don't like the car, you can return it within the first month for free. No questions asked. You get the complete reimbursement. And that's the kind of experience a lot of millennials are expecting in every aspect of their life, because that's what they're used to with Uber, with Swiggy. So what can we learn from that? Can we create an experienced candidate fit when it comes to recruitment? Can we create similar experiences for candidates? And yesterday today morning we played the video where we have a candidate who is in public transport. He is used to instant fulfillment. We always use the word instant gratification, but gratification always have a negative connotation to it. But you can't blame millennials or people who have been used to getting instant fulfillment because of Jeff Bezos or because of other people, but you need to really adopt your recruitment process to meet that requirement. So that becomes today's candidate expectation becomes instant fulfillment, which I believe is a key learning for all of us based on what we saw at Carvana. The next one is an example of business model disruption. And this is actually a company which has been around for quite some time. I think the 82 years old company. But they recently started doing some things very differently. And they always had a return policy, but now they don't ask you any questions for return within a year. So you can buy any product from them. You can go back and return it, even if it is wear and tear and any of those issues, you can just give it back. And that has completely changed their business model, because now they have built a community of users who are so passionate about the brand that they would go to any extent to promote that amongst all of their people they are connected to. And that is, on a daily basis, REI has a community which is growing at almost, I think they're adding around 20,000 people every day right now with the new program. And can we learn from this and look at how we can disrupt hiring model? How can we change the paradigms or change the rules which we have set for ourselves when it comes to this is the way we are going to hire? Can we relook at that?
And essentially, I think that's one of the examples we spoke about, and these are all examples. There are multiple ways in which you can bring this forward. But in our experience working with customers, the qualified warm pool, where essentially you have a candidate who have gone through interviews, assessments in the past, but did not get hired or did not end up joining because of a budget or timing or location issue, maybe one skill set did not match. If that candidate is coming back, do you really need them to go through the same process all over again? So in fact, we are working with this one customer. Their vision is that if a candidate went through the process, did not end up joining, the next time they have a suitable job for that candidate, they just want to pick up the phone and tell the candidate, hey, we have a job waiting for you. Can you come and join us? So that's the kind of hiring model disruption companies are looking at right now. And that's what I would learn from an example like REI. The next one is about low friction. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with Atlassian. Again, they're not a startup. They have been around for quite some time, $32 billion market cap. They have customers who are buying $1 million or more worth software from them without any sales reps. So they don't have sales reps. Their entire philosophy is around how can we remove friction from every aspect of the buying process. So everything from the way they do marketing to sales to contracting. They want to ensure that rather than the customer is being sold to, they want the customer to buy from them. And that's the kind of experience which has helped them to build this $32 billion market cap company in a space which is not, I would say, not the most innovative space, but they have a different story to tell. How can we create a frictionless candidate experience? And that would be my learning from this story. And I think that's really about any time, anywhere, any device. Because if you expect your candidate to be in a particular device, or they have to take a day's leave and travel all the way to your office for an interview or any part of the hiring process, or they have to be in a particular geography, that's really friction. All of these are friction points within your hiring process. So how can you systematically go ahead and remove friction from your process? That's what my learning from this particular company. Next one is about personalization, and I know all of you, this is the most common example of personalization, but when the Netflix CEO talks about personalization, he talks about psychographics, which is essentially, they have a unique fingerprint for each of us in their database. So my fingerprints are unique by default. So essentially, every user, based on their consumption pattern, they have been able to make a complete fingerprint so that every time you log in, so even from the same account when you log in, if there are multiple users, the kind of recommendations, the kind of feeds you see, everything is customized. Even the kind of notifications they send you, what time of the day, are they sending it on mobile, are they showing you pop-ups on the browser, everything is based on your unique fingerprint. And that's the level of personalization which technology today allows you to do. So what can we do from a candidate experience personalization standpoint? And I think it starts with the most basic thing, which is recommending the right job for the candidate, because you understand your organization much better than the candidate. And you also today have the ability to understand a lot more about the candidate even before you start talking to them. So rather than expecting a candidate to come to your career website and then search for these jobs, go through the job, and then figure out himself or herself that particular job is suitable, can we recommend the right job to the candidates through a bot or maybe through other mechanisms on your career website? Because you understand both sides, the candidate only understands his side. And that, I would say, is my learning from this particular use case. The next one is about just in time. And I have a video here. is always, because we talk about passive candidates, we talk about active candidates. But how do you, so for example, in this particular case, the person is yawning, but he's not actively saying that he needs a coffee right now. And the technology is actually enabling you to identify that while he's not asking for a coffee or pressing a button, the fact that he's yawning means he needs a coffee, and that would help him. I think that's the same thing about just-in-time hiring. How do you understand that, okay, there's a candidate who is now looking for a career upgrade, or there's a candidate who's looking for a new home, and how do you understand whether that home, you are that potential home, you are the right fit for him, and then showcase your best job to that particular candidate at that particular point. I think that's all just-in-time is about. And there is another aspect of how do you also predict your hiring needs. I think yesterday we spoke about what Talview is trying to do with Salesforce, how we are looking at data within your CRMs to understand whether you need a new sales guy or whether you are about to win a new project and do you need to start sourcing for skill sets for that particular project. So those are the kind of predictive hiring requirements which we see, and for me that's the learning from this particular video. The last one is about selling through customers. So Glossier is a company which essentially has built their entire business model by getting their customers to sell. So once you become a customer, it's and you use their product and you love their product, the customer can actually start their own franchisee of the Glossier platform, and they can start selling their products to their network. So they have built. So the difference between Glossier and what a traditional multi-level marketing organization do is, because in this case, the customer doesn't get incentivized to sell this product because they don't get incentivized in the way the chains work. So you will sell something only if you're 100% happy about it. And these are people who are not typically looking for an additional income. These are people who really love the product and they want to now talk about it to more people in their network, and by doing that, they also have the ability to earn more money. So this is also, I think, the same from this particular example. For me, can we use candidates for driving referrals? Because if you are creating candidate experiences, which is leaving an impact about your organization, even if they don't join your organization, or even if you are not giving them an offer. But just by building those experiences, can you leverage that as your biggest branding opportunity and get more candidates up on the top of your funnel? That would be my learning from this particular example. In fact, there is this concept of human network which Reid Hoffman, the founder of LinkedIn, keeps talking about, where if you look at any particular employee or candidate whom you are talking to or working with, there are probably 20 to 30 people in his immediate network who are very similar. Some people from probably the same education institution or people from his previous organization who are very similar to this particular person and are almost 60% more, I would say, have 60% higher chance of being a better fit for your organization just by the fact that they are part of the same human network. And I think Chad is going to talk about in his keynote about talent pools, which is built on this entire concept of human network, which is a very interesting concept for me. So what did we learn overall? So I think if we look at disruptors, there are a lot of learnings which we have, everything from how do we create an experienced candidate fit, how can we drive referrals through candidates like we just saw, how can we create frictionless candidate experience. So there are a lot of these learnings which I believe us the recruitment community, when we look at different business models which are evolving across the globe, there's a lot to be learned. And how can we adopt the best of these ideas and make that part of our hiring process? That will differentiate us from the rest of the organizations. And so what that translates to, so we spoke about why we need to do something, because this is what the candidate community is expecting. And how can we do that? But for me, and I'm probably biased, but we truly believe that if you take the crux of all of this, it boils down to how we can create remote, automate, reuse experiences for candidates, and which is engaging, which is delivering the kind of experience which you, the candidates would love to be part of. And that, for me, is all about Instahiring. And that's why we are all here today to, yesterday and today to discuss about this. Today, again, we have a great day of sessions. So we have multiple panel discussions. All of them are very interesting. We have the Trailblazer presentations, the continuation of Trailblazer presentations from yesterday. We also have a lot of networking opportunities. And then we have a keynote from Chad, who is Talview's VP of Marketing. And he has spent a lot of time in this space. So he has very unique perspectives. And I'm sure you that's something which all of you will enjoy today. And apart from that, we also have the Trailblazer Award. So we'll announce the winners towards the end of the day. And that's something which we are all excited about at Talview. Some of the speakers, I already spoke about this. I'm sure many of you have availed the Braindates opportunity yesterday. So this is an opportunity for you to discuss your current priorities and challenges with Instahiring advisors, people who have worked with multiple organizations and have a lot of case studies about how Instahiring and other aspects of technology has been leveraged in those organizations. So please continue to, you can ask any representative from Talview to schedule a brain date and have those conversations during the rest of the day. We have the booths. We got great feedback. Thanks for all the feedback which you gave to the team yesterday. Please continue doing that. Ensure that you visit all the booths and interact with the teams, and we will ensure that wherever you're giving feedback, the team will follow up with you with updates from our end. Thank you.